Hey guys, it's John from Enduring Charm. Today I'm going to do a video on how to use digital multimeters around your home. These are a really useful tool in a lot of ways, but people are intimidated by them if they don't know a lot about them. So today I'm just going to go over some of the very basics and help you use one of these tools in your own home. All right, the first problem a lot of you are going to have is there's a lot of little dials and numbers and controls on these meters. And if you don't know what you're doing, it's very intimidating. Here's one. This one's actually meant for automotive use. Here's another one. That looks totally different. Here's a third one. That looks totally different. But in reality, all of these multimeters are going to share a lot of the same settings. And it's easy to understand once you get a grip on it. All right, the simplest setting on all these digital multimeters is voltage, and it's a very useful thing to measure in a lot of instances, and I'm going to give you some examples. And finding how to measure voltage on these meters is also pretty easy. But all these meters are going to have two settings, one for DC voltage, which is batteries and that kind of thing, and one for AC voltage, which is household current. Okay, if you look at this meter, same thing. Now this is done a little bit differently, but it's got a dial. So this whole area here is DC voltage, and this area here is AC voltage, all right? On this meter, it's done a little bit differently. You have one whole area that's meant for voltage, all right? See the V right there? And then you have a button to push down whether you want to measure DC or AC voltage, okay? If it's up, you're measuring DC voltage. If it's down, you're measuring AC voltage. And then all these meters are going to have a range. So it measures from very low to very high. In this case, 600 volts is the high reading. So if you're measuring a battery, for example, let's say a 12-volt battery, you would set this to 20, which is the high reading. It's as high as the meter is going to measure. And you'd push this, you'd leave this button up for DC voltage, and that would allow you to measure battery voltage, all right? If you were measuring household current, you'd bump this up to 200 volts and push this button down, and that lets you read up to 200 volts. In household current, you're going to have 110 or 120, I'll explain that in a minute, or you're going to have maybe 220 volts. But if you set this too high, nothing's going to happen, it's just that it's set higher than you really need. If you set it too low, like if you're measuring household current at 110 and you set this at 20, it's going to limit the meter to 20, so that's not going to be useful. So nothing will go wrong, it's just that you want to set the meter to the type of voltage that you're measuring. Now, these meters are going to have things that you probably won't be using in a lot of cases, but there's two other areas of measurement that I want to bring to your attention. One is ohms, which is a measure of resistance. And you're going to see this little symbol here, that, all right, kind of omega symbol here. And that indicates when you set the meter to that you're measuring ohms. And I'm going to get into that in a minute. On this meter, same thing. You see that little symbol right here? That tells you you're reading ohms. And there's a range of scale here. On this meter, where is it here? Ohms is up here, okay? So here, see the symbol up here? And here's the scale that you could be reading on, the different markings. So that's a very important feature we're going to get into. And then the last thing I want to mention, most of these meters have a setting for continuity, which this is what it looks like here, which really just means either there's connectivity on a wire, say, between one end or another, or there isn't. So it's on or off. On this meter, it's down here. Okay, so there's your continuity. On this meter, it is right here. So there's your continuity. But again, this isn't really a scale. It's either on or off. And I'll get into that in a minute. So those are the three settings I'm going to talk about today. It's voltage, which is over here in this meter, your ohms, which is a measure of resistance in a wire, and your continuity, which is on or off. Okay, those are the three most useful things, I think, for around a house. Although there are other things you may be using. This meter, for example, has a specific area to measure batteries, for example. And if your meter has that, you can use that. But the voltage, the ohms, and the continuity, I think, are very common across all digital multimeters. One last thing I want to mention when we're talking about how to plug all this in. A lot of meters have more than one place to plug in the leads. All right, you always have a red lead and a black lead. The black lead is usually the ground or the common, it's called, and the red one may be plugged into different areas. But for what we're talking about today, you're always going to want it in the fused section rather than the unfused. All right, here's the voltage test. We're plugging directly into the household current, and we're reading 120 volts, or 120.6, I should say. And you can stick the meter right into the outlet. It's not going to hurt anything. Now, this test may be useful. For example, if you notice that your light bulbs are blowing, your incandescent light bulbs, I should say, are blowing constantly, you may have a high voltage condition from the power company. So if you notice, you know, the power is measuring 130 volts, for example, that's too much, and there's a problem that the power company needs to deal with. On the other hand, if you're measuring voltage that's too low here, let's say it's, you know, below 110, you know, 100 volts, say, you're going to notice your incandescent light bulbs are burning not very bright, and the problem may be the power company. It could also be within your house, but more likely the power company. So measuring the voltage can be useful in determining whether the power company is giving you a problem or not. You can also check, you know, different outlets that way. So, you know, if one outlet is working and another one is not, you can plug in here and just make sure they're all measuring the same voltage. In this case, 120.6. So that's correct. Alternating current voltage, it goes back and forth, basically, is the easiest way to describe it. So in a battery, for example, which is direct current and DC voltage, there's basically a single current that goes, you know, from one side to another, period. In alternating current voltage, the current goes back and forth in kind of a sine wave, they call it. And that's how we get power to go above 120, because you're getting two legs or hot sides from the power company fed into your home. So 120 is actually one side or one leg of what's being fed into your home. To get the 220 or 240 volt is actually more accurate. You're using both of those legs at the same time. So it is possible in your house that one leg that is being fed into your house is failing or has a problem, and the other leg is okay. And I've seen that before. All right, I'm here in my shop, and this is where I plug my table saw into. So I'm measuring 242 volts. And remember, now I've changed my scale to the 600 volt on this particular meter. And so now I'm measuring 242 volts. So that's 2 times 120, basically, is how I get to that 240, and that's correct. So this is good. Now, just to show you something, if I take out, there's two hot legs on this. If I take out one of these and put it on the ground, I'll probably have to hold it in there. I should measure if I get a good contact here. There we go. So to ground, one hot leg to ground, I'm measuring 120 or 121. That's correct. All right, let's talk about DC voltage then. Let's say I need to measure the voltage of this battery to make sure the battery is still good. I set my meter to DC, and I set my scale to 20. I could set it to 2 in this case. This is a AAA battery, which should be 1.5 volts. So if I put my leads on my end here, I got my, see if I can do this, keep it on camera. So I'm holding my leads on here. All right, can you see that? So I'm measuring 1.56 volts, DC volts, on this battery, which is excellent. So this battery's in good shape. If this battery were older and worn, that voltage is going to go down. And at some point, it's going to get to below 1.5 volts and a lot below 1.5 volts. And at that point, the battery's kind of done. Rechargeable tool batteries can be tested with voltage as well. Here I should have 18 volts on this battery, and I've got 18.8, so I'm in good shape. But if that voltage were below 18, I know this battery's on the way out. Here's another example where you might measure DC voltage in a tractor or a mower or a car. Now, all these systems in the modern world are 12-volt systems. And actually, I don't know if you can see this, but I have a little clip here to help me hold the... There's the other end of that. Helps me hold the negative side in place here just so I can do this with one hand. So I have that connected to the negative side. And if I take my positive lead and push it on the positive side, sure enough, I'm getting 12.4 volts. out of this battery, which is good. Now this engine is not running, obviously, and you want to see at least 12 or a little bit more from a battery. If you have that, you're in good shape. When the engine is actually running, and be careful if you're trying to measure that when it's running, because you can get this thing caught up in the engine, but it should be a little more than it is at rest. So if I'm getting 12.4 volts here, I probably want to see something a little closer to 13 volts when the engine's running. So you can measure voltage. Now, if the voltage is quite low, the battery is discharged and you have a problem. So this can be used especially, you know, if you have your mower sitting, you know, all winter and it hasn't been run, you could check the battery, make sure the battery's in good shape before you go off to mow your lawn. One quick thing to understand about automotive and tractors and applications like that when they use the battery, all these systems have a negative side on the DC system, right? And that negative is grounded, or in other words, it runs through the frame of the car or the tractor or whatever it is. And the hot side, or the positive side, which is usually indicated by a red wire, the power returns to that through the frame. So you have to be a little bit careful when you're working with this. If you touch this positive side to the frame, you're going to get a spark. All right, the next test we'll talk about is continuity, which is really just a test of an electrical connection between one place and another. So like one end of a wire to another end of a wire. And the continuity test is really just on or off. So I've put my meter on that little symbol there, which indicates continuity test. And it's going to make a sound when I touch the two leads together. Listen up. So when I touch that together and there is continuity, the sound will occur. If I touch something else, like the wood or something, you're not going to get any continuity. So this is really a basic test, but it can be used to test, for example, an extension cord. Here I have an extension cord, and what I've done is just use these little alligator clips, they call them. Let me just show you what that looks like. It's just these alligator clips, right? And that just helps me hold that on there. So I'm going to put the alligator clip on the ground of this extension cord, and it's connected to the test lead here, you'll see. And on the other side, I can plug my other lead in and see if there's continuity to ground. Let's listen. So if I want to test an extension cord to make sure there is a good ground, I can use a continuity test. Using the continuity feature, you can test switches to make sure the on-off function is working right. You can use the continuity to make sure that lighting fixtures are working correctly. Continuity testers can also be used to trace wiring. So on a telephone line, for example, if you want to make sure the wires are connected, right? That one's not, that one is. Now the ohmmeter setting can also be used to test connectivity. But it will also give you a measure of resistance, not just whether it's on or off. So this is a more finite test, and it can be useful in a lot of situations too. Now an ohmmeter, when there is no connectivity at all, in other words, the resistance is infinite, it's going to read 1. If you connect a wire and there is no real resistance, or at least on the scale that you've picked, then it's going to read 0. So I have one measurement here right now. If I take this alligator clip, which is the other side of this, and it's just a short wire, and I connect it to my test lead, you'll see the ohmmeter now reads 0. Now, if I choose a finer scale, the ohmmeter might give me a reading here. I could try it for the hell of it, but yeah, so if I choose a finer scale here, now I'm getting a reading of 0.1. So the scale will determine whether this reads 0 or not sometimes, because there's almost always going to be some resistance. But in this case, it's very, very small. If I put the scale back up to a more normal rating, it's going to read 0 again. So again, if we're testing for continuity, we can do the same thing we did before, although in this case, we don't get a sound. We get a measurement or reading. So I have my alligator clip set up on my ground on the extension cord again. And if I plug this into this side, I'm trying to do this on camera, I get 0 now, okay? If I take this out, it's going to read 1. If I put it back on the ground, it's going to read 0. Now, if you get into using an ohmmeter for diagnosing an electronic circuit, you're going to have to check with the manufacturer of that circuit to determine, you know, what different resistances should be. So an ohmmeter might be used in an automotive setting if you're diagnosing some of the computer areas of a car, or if you have, for example, a refrigerator with an electronic that went bad, or a dishwasher, or a furnace. All of these things have electronics now, and so the ohmmeter may be used to diagnose certain parts of a circuit, in which case you're going to follow the directions in the manufacturer's diagnostic procedures to determine what a certain resistance should be. So that's some of the real basic uses for a multimeter. These things, literally this one here, if you go to Harbor Freight, they will give it to you. That's how cheap they can be. And most of these you can buy, you know, at a Walmart or a Home Depot or a Lowe's or something like that for absolutely nothing. It's, you know, $10 maybe, and you can get a decent multimeter to do this kind of work. As I said, they have a lot of other functions and features that as you get more advanced you may want to use, but a homeowner really should have one of these on hand just to test some very basic things, and it can be a very useful tool to have in your toolbox.